Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip, and today I'm going to talk to you about linear and binary search with arrays. So when we want to search, what we're doing is looking through a set of items, an array or a list, to see if the list contains a particular item, and we call that the key value. So there are two really fundamental algorithms, and one is linear search. So this is where we're going to go through in what we would call a sort of a brute force manner. We're going to look at every element in the array or the list, one element at a time. This can be kind of slow, but it can handle any list. We don't need to worry about what the list looks like. The binary search is a divide and conquer approach. So we're going to repeatedly divide the list in half and only look at the half that we're left with. This is a much faster approach, but it only works if the list or the array contains items that are sorted. So let's first look at linear search. Here's the code for a basic linear search. This is a function that takes in an array of integers, and it takes in a size, an integer, and it takes in the key, what we're searching for. So what we see here is that we're going to loop through. We have a for loop, and we're going to loop from 0 up to the size of the array. So again, we can do this with a partially filled array. And we're going to increment one by one through this for loop. And we're going to look at the item in that list, at that index, and see if it is the same as the key that we're searching for. And so if it is, then we're going to return that index because now we've found the item. And if it's not, then we're going to actually return -1. So if we get through all of the slots in the array up to size, and we haven't ever found the item that we're looking for, the key, then we return -1. So either we're going to return an index, which is where we found the item, or we're going to return -1. So that way we can know whether or not we found the key that we were looking for. So linear search is what in computer science we would define as O(n) or order n or linear. And that's because it scales linearly with the size of the data. So if you've got a small array of 30 items, it's going to be pretty fast. But if you've got an array that has 300,000 items in it, it's going to be kind of slow because it could potentially have to check through all 300,000 items. So it really scales in linear fashion with the size of the data set. So linear search is fine. It's straightforward. It's simple. And especially for small lists, it's reasonably okay. But imagine this problem. Imagine we're searching through the entire list of the University of Manitoba student names, 30,000, and we're looking to see if we have a student named Jenny Wong. And we start at the beginning and we say, the first student is Aaron Adams. Is that Jenny Wong? No. Beth Adams? No. Asif Adlahi? No. So I think you start to get the point that Jenny Wong, if this list is alphabetized by last name, is going to be way at the end of the list, if it's in the list at all. And so doing a linear search where we look at items one by one is going to be super slow. And the point here is that if we have a list that's actually already sorted, it just wouldn't make sense to do this. Think about a stack of papers on your desk. If you're looking for a piece of paper that you know you put in that stack a long time ago, you're going to look at the bottom of the stack, not the top of the stack. So what we want to do is just be a little bit smarter about how we look at this list or array of items when we know it's in a specific order. And so that's what binary search does. If we have a sorted list, binary search is much faster. And the idea is divide and conquer. We're going to split the list in half, look at the midpoint, and see if it matches what we're looking for. And if not, we're going to either go to the left side or the right side, depending on whether the midpoint is bigger than or smaller than the thing we're looking for, because it's in sorted order. So we just keep on doing this until we get to the point where either we found the item or we have nothing left to look through. So we're going to be keeping track of sections of an array. So we're going to go from list low to list high. And in this case, what we do is initially low is 0, which is the index of the first slot in the array, and high is size -1, which is where our last data item is in the array. So let's look at an example, one step of a binary search. We're only looking at the part of the array that goes from list low to list high, and we're going to pick the middle element in that range. So we're going to do a calculation to get mid as an index, and that's going to be low plus high divided by 2. So that's going to give us the index that's halfway between low and high. And then we're going to look at that, at the element at that index, and say, is that the same as the key? If it is, then we found what we're looking for, and we can return mid, which is the index where the key was found. But if it's not, then either the item in the middle is greater than the key, in which case we want to, the key can only be in the first half, or the item in the list is actually less than the key, in which case the key is going to be in the second half. So let's look at this first example. If the item in the list at the middle is greater than our key, then the key's only going to be in the part of the list that's to the left. So list mid is too big, and so everything above list mid has to be even bigger because it's a sorted list. And so what we do then is we change our high value to be mid minus 1. So now what we're going to do is we're only going to look at the list from low up to mid minus 1. And so now we've gotten rid of half of the list on the right-hand side, and we're going to focus on the left. If when we looked at the value in the middle of the list and it was less than the key, then the key can only be on the right-hand side in the second half of the list. And so what we do then is we change our low value to be mid plus 1. And so now we've discarded the whole left half of the list, and we're going to do this again with the list that's on the right-hand side. Okay, and we're just going to keep on going until we find our key, or we run out of places to look. And we'll know we've run out of places to look when we actually get low being greater than high, and the two indices are kind of have gone past each other. So let's look at an example here. So here's a list. It's sorted. It's got these values in it. These are integers. And we're looking to see if 4 is in the list. Now, of course, you and I at a glance can say, like, yeah, it's right there. But a computer can't do that. A computer has to do this step by step because it doesn't have that same capability. So we're going to start with low being 0, the index of the first element, and high being 8, the index of the last element. And we're going to search. So we are going to find the middle. So middle is low plus high divided by 2, or 0 plus 8 divided by 2, which gives us 4. So 4 is the index of the middle. And we're going to look at list of 4, and the value in that slot is 8. And 8 is too big. We're looking for a value that is 4, and 8's bigger than 4. So what we're going to do is we're going to change our high value to be mid minus 1. So mid is 4, so we're going to change our high value to be 3. So now what we've done in that step, if you look here, we were looking at this whole list. And now, because of moving our index, our high index, we've basically discarded all these elements over here. We've said they're not relevant to our search. So now we do this over again. So now we have low of 0, high of 3. We find our mid value, so 0 plus 3 divided by 2. Integer division here will give us 1. And so we're going to check what's at list of 1, which is 3. So that's the value that's in this slot. 3 is too small. We're looking for 4. So now what we're going to do is we're going to change low to be mid plus 1. So again, mid is 1. So now low is going to be pointing at slot 2. So that's what we've got here. So in this step, we went from a list with 4 items. We discarded everything on the left-hand side. And now we have this smaller list that's got 2 items. So our list is halving in size each step of this. And so now we're going to find our middle. So low plus high divided by 2, 2 plus 3 divided by 2. Again, integer division, that'll give us 2. So our middle is this slot. We check what's in this slot. It's 4. That matches our key. So we found what we're looking for. And now in this case, what we do is we return 2, which is the index where we found the key. Okay. What about what happens if what we're looking for just isn't in the array at all? How does this work out? So Here we've changed the values in our array slightly. We're still looking for 4, but 4 is no longer in here. So let's step through and see what this looks like. Again, we start with low of 0, high of 8. We get the mid value and, wait, let me go back. We get the mid value, which is 4. We look at 8. 8 is a lot bigger than 4, so we're going to discard everything to the right. And we change high to point at 4 minus 1 at 3. Now we're doing the same thing. We have low of 0, high of 3. We calculate our mid value of 1. We look at what's in slot 1. It's 3. That's actually smaller than our key, so we're going to discard stuff to the left and change low. So now low is pointing at 2, high is pointing at 3, and we're going to find our middle slot. It's 2. We check what's there. It's 5. That's too big, so we're going to get set high to mid minus 1, and our mid is 2. So mid minus 1 is 1, so we're going to set our high to 1. So now in this iteration, suddenly we've got low and high switched over there backwards. And what that tells us is that we've actually finished searching and we're not going to find our key. And so this is, it's just basically like, this is impossible. It has to be in list 2 because, or above because low is 2. It has to be in list 1 or below because high is 1, but that's impossible. So it can't be anywhere. And so in that case, we would return negative 1. So this is what the binary search code looks like. We are going to pass in an array of ints. We are going to pass in the size because this could be a partially filled array. We're going to pass in the int key, what we're looking for, and we're going to return an int. So what we're going to return is the index of where we found the key or negative 1 if we don't find the key. So we start off by setting low to be 0 and high to be size minus 1. And we're going to keep on dividing and searching and dividing and looking at the middle value and dividing and looking at the middle value until we get to that point where the two indices, the low and the high, cross over each other. So as long as low is less than or equal to high, we'll look again. We still have slots to search. So our first step will be find the middle index, and then we'll check what's in the slot at that middle index and see if it equals key. If it does, we're going to return that index. If it doesn't, then we have to check is what's in that slot less than key. And if it's less than key, then we change low to be mid plus 1. If what's in that slot is actually greater than key, then we change our high index to be mid minus 1. And we repeat with a half of the list. And we're just going to keep on repeating with half of the list, calculating mid, looking at it, etc., over and over again. If we get to the point where we've gone through all of this and we never found anything and our low and high are switched over, then we know we didn't find it and we return negative 1. So what we want to think about is, how did these two different approaches, the linear search versus the binary search, really compare? And the difference between these two algorithms is huge. So let's think about what happens if we double the list size and how many different iterations we have to do. So if we have a list size of 10, we potentially have to do 10 iterations of the for loop to look at each item in the array. If we have a list size of 10, the most times we're going to have to do the search to divide it is 4, because the first time we divide it, we'll get a list size of 5. The second time we divide it, we'll get a list size of 2. The next time we'll get a list size of 1. So you can see that we're going to have to divide this. We can only divide it so many times before we have nothing left. Now, if we double our list size from 10 to 20, now we're going to have to do 20 iterations in our linear search. But from 10 to 20, well, we divide 20 once and we divide it in half once and we get to 10. And so really it's only one more iteration. And so if you start to do these calculations, a list size of 1,000, it's going to take about 10 iterations of binary search, but it's going to be 1,000 iterations of the for loop and linear search. And so you can start to see that as the list size scales up, the number of iterations that we have to do of looking at items in the linear search is huge. And the number of things we have to look at with binary search is really small. So binary search is really, really efficient. It's fantastically efficient. But binary search requires that your list is actually sorted. It just doesn't work if the list is not sorted. If the numbers are in random order, you can't divide and throw away half the list because what you're looking for might have been in that half. So what you have to do is either keep the list sorted as you build it, or you have to take an existing list that you have, and then you have to sort it by applying some kind of sorting algorithm. And sorting a list is also a pretty slow operation. In fact, sorting a list is slower than a linear search. So if you have a list that's not sorted, to sort it so that you can do linear search or binary search is less efficient than just going ahead and doing the linear search. So what you really want to do is use binary search when you already have a sorted list. If you plan to do lots and lots of searching and your list doesn't change very often, then you can just sort once and keep it sorted. And then you can do lots of searching. That's when that makes sense for binary search. If you have to do lots of searching and your searches need to be really fast and you've got lots of time to do a sort, such as like overnight, then that makes sense as well. So there's trade-offs here between binary search and linear search. All right, so hopefully that gives you a good sense of binary versus linear search. Thanks for watching.